Thank you for joining us on SH Skincare & Co. Q2 and H1 FY 2021 earnings conference call. We have with us Mr. Kedar Vaze, Whole-time Director and Group CEO, Mr. B. Ramakrishnan, Head Strategy, and Mr. Srikanth Mate, VP and Group CFO of the company. We will begin the call with opening remarks from the management, following which we'll have the forum open for a question and answer session. Before we start, I would like to point out that some statements made in today's call may be forward-looking in nature, and a disclaimer to this effect has been included in the earnings presentation shared with you earlier. I would now like to invite Kedar to make his opening remarks.
Thank you, Anup. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us on our quarter two and H1 FY 2021 earnings call to discuss the operating and financial performance for the quarter. I trust you and your families are safe and maintaining all precautions against the spread of COVID-19. To begin with, I am pleased to share that we have delivered a robust performance during the quarter on the back of healthy uptick in demand across both the domestic and the international markets. Increased traction in engagement with large and mid-size FMCG customers led to new business wins across various categories, further laying a solid foundation for us to deliver multi-year growth. In addition, our wholly owned subsidiary, CFF, also delivered an encouraging performance. I would like to highlight here that the quarter's performance includes consolidation of CFF numbers with effect from 1st August 2020. On a consolidated basis, our revenues from operations stood at 351.9 crores, and on a like-to-like basis, excluding the CFF, our revenues in quarter two was higher by 14% year-on-year. On the profitability front, higher operating leverage and better product mix enabled us to report strong performance during the quarter. This, along with a stable raw material environment and cost optimization measures executed over the last few quarters, further enhanced margin performance during the quarter. Our gross margins during the quarter stood at 44%, while EBITDA margins improved to 21%. CFF also delivered steady performance in its core fragrance division, driven by increased demand and volume offtake in the Italian and other European markets. Gross margins in the core fragrance segment remained strong at 54%. Reported PAT, including an exceptional income of 12.5 crores, which was recorded on account of remeasurement of our stake in CFF after it was recognized as a wholly owned subsidiary. Excluding this amount, the PAT stood strong at rupees 41.3 crores, higher by 176% year-on-year. On the segmental basis, the fragrance division witnessed healthy pickup in demand and saw improved business wins as the country moved to the unlockdown phase. The flavor division, we launched new product offerings, which saw strong acceptance in the domestic and international markets. This, in addition to improved recovery in the demand environment, resulted in healthy sales during the quarter. From a consolidated balance sheet perspective, as on 30th September 2020, the company's net debt position stood at rupees 454 crores. This includes consolidation of the CFF debt and the payment of the second and final tranche of the CFF acquisition of about 141 crores. Excluding CFF debt and acquisition payment, our net debt was steady at rupees 249 crores. Going forward, we have no major CapEx plans on hand, and the focus remains on setting current investments and generating healthy free cash flows. Accordingly, I'm also happy to share here that the board of directors has declared an interim dividend of rupees 1 per share. This is in line with our dividend distribution policy while maintaining a healthy balance sheet position. As we look ahead, a combination of improving economic indicators and the festive season should help strengthen demand and consumption across the country. This will enable us to sustain our momentum going forward. After witnessing one of the most challenging periods in the F&F industry over the past few years, we believe we are firmly back on track to deliver healthy and sustainable growth in the near to medium term. While there is reasonable optimism on the domestic front, the second wave of COVID in Europe and elsewhere needs to be factored. We are taking all measures to mitigate the risk and ensure the safety of our people. Furthermore, we are monitoring our operations and processes such that it poses minimal risk for the spread of this disease. However, it is difficult to estimate the impact of this development on the results of the rest of the year. On that note, I would request the moderator to open the forum for any questions and suggestions that you may have.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handset while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Alpesh Thakkar from Motilal Oswal Financial Services. Thank you. Please go ahead.
Yeah. First of all, congratulations for a very good set of numbers, sir. My first question is on, we have talked about new customer wins across categories. Can you please throw some light on the customers where we have won these deals and segments, whether it is in flavors or fragrances, and how huge is this opportunity in terms of annual run rate, because it's a multi-year deal that we are talking about. So any information on that would be very helpful, sir.
So it is both wins in fragrances as well as flavors. We have pretty much across the board all the customers. We have seen good traction of new developments, particularly in the health and wellness. New launches around health soaps, around sanitizers, around specific health benefit products. So we have got a large number of wins. On an estimated first half, we have clocked roughly 35 crores of new win potential, which should help us continue the growth trajectory in the years to come.
Okay. So, sir, are these domestic or the international side? Hello.
Sir, requesting you to please stay on time because we're trying to reconnect, sir, back to the conference. Requesting participants to please stay online. We are just trying to reconnect the chairperson back to the call. In the meanwhile, the other host is unmuted. So you all may please go ahead while I connect the speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for patiently holding the line. We have the speaker reconnected to the conference. So we had the question from the line of Alpesh Thakkar. You may please proceed.
So second question was, sir, in the flavors division, we saw a very big jump in the margin. So that was, because of the product mix that you have talked about. So can you elaborate a little bit on that and what can be the sustainable margin in that business?
So I think as the flavor business, we have a higher share of exports in this quarter. That is boosting the overall margin profile. I think we still are at maybe 2-3% higher gross margin overall than the trend line which we expected. And it will be around the same 50% gross margin level where we expect flavors to be on a sustainable basis.
Okay, that was helpful. And just one clarification from the earlier question. So you were talking about 35 crore run rate. So was that quarterly run rate from the new win?
No, so 35 crore is the new revenue from the new wins of this year. So next year we should expect 35 odd crore of new revenue from what we have made the new developments this year.
Okay, got it. Thank you. That's all from my side. And happy Diwali in advance. Yes.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Ms. S. Baya, individual investor. Please go away.
Hello.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. Thank you for the opportunity, sir, and congratulations on a good set of numbers.
So just on a broad level, you know, we have had a couple of challenging times in the past few years, and we have steered through them pretty well. But just in hindsight, is there, you know, anything you would have done differently, or, you know, and going forward, will we change our approach in any way? Like, if you can.
No, so we had this same question earlier 2 quarters back. I think In hindsight, we could have taken lesser risk and been more conservative in our investment and growth strategy. As I mentioned at that time, we have now restructured the outlook of the business on a business unit by business unit and region by region, which helps us to react to any specific changes in a much faster manner.
Okay. Thank you, sir. I saw then the last question, just how do you see the raw material prices going in the next few quarters? If you can give some sense of how it might.
So I think the raw material prices are at the beginning of this year after the pandemic has been at a very low level. We expect that the raw material prices will more correct slightly in the coming quarters. There is a lot of factors which are playing out, and at this moment it is difficult to assess how the market trend or the raw material situation will be. We have fair visibility on our contracts and stock in hand for the next 2 quarters. So for us, the raw material prices will remain more or less the same. Maybe a couple of percentage higher cost towards the end of the fiscal year.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. That's all from the side. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sabyasachi Mukherjee from Centrum PMS. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the opportunity. I have 2 questions. Firstly, on your you know, quarterly performance, we have clocked around, you know, 350 crores of revenue and EBITDA margin of, you know, 20%. This has been this 350 crore number and the 20% kind of EBITDA margin number has not been seen probably in the last 10-12 quarters in a long time. What is the sustainability of such run rate in the quarterly, both in terms of revenue and margin, if you can throw some light?
So I think if you look at the revenue run rate, excepting for the last quarter, we have been looking at a 2-3% sequential quarter-on-quarter growth. That has been the track. So this quarter is on the same trend. I would expect, subject to just keeping in mind the second wave of corona internationally, to understand its effect, if any. But otherwise, I would expect the demand to continue to grow at this pace, 10-12% per annum, and we will continue to grow sequentially 2-3% per quarter. On that line, our last couple of years have had a lot of macro events with GST and gross margin. And as I mentioned earlier on the call, we have had to take corrective steps, and we have taken most of those and built our business back in line with the current revenue and cost structure. So I think this is now the reset of the business post the couple of years, and from here on we see this to be sustainable. We have already guided 43% gross margin and a ballpark 20% EBITDA level, and we will maintain that glide path with a 10-12% growth rate year on year.
Just related to that, is it something that, you know, some of the Q1 revenues got you know, spilled over to Q2, and that's why we are seeing such a sharp YOY jump in Q2? Is that a correct understanding?
To some extent, although I see a similar trend in the first half of this quarter, so there is no sharp drop in the demand situation. So we believe that we will have similar quarters going forward. There is no specific kind of one-off or catch-up demand in this quarter.
Okay. My second question is bit on the longer term. If I look at your numbers, from FY16 or FY17, and I look at the gross assets, gross block, net block number, and the sales number, your gross block or be it net block, it has almost doubled because I think you have done good amount of capex in 19 and 20. And now this inorganic acquisition, but your sales have almost hovered from 900 to 1000 to 1100 crores kind of a range. Now, what is your long-term outlook? Probably 3 years or 5 years. You are currently at probably $150 million kind of a revenue, where the other global players are much bigger in size. Can we reach to a level of something of $500 million in probably 5 years? What is your long-term outlook on the
same? So our chairman and my father, Ramesh Vase, has already put out a few years ago to direct us to making a $1 billion fragrance and flavor company. So we are making all steps necessary to go in that direction. I think the question of results, we have continued to do the right investments and the right management steps. There have been many factors, partly outside our control, which has affected the last 2-3 years. We wish to just continue to do the right things, and we are very confident that these results will be sustainable, and we will be on this track going forward.
Great to hear, sir. Great. Thank you. Thanks a lot. That's all from my side.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Deepak Poddar from Sapphire Capital. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much, sir, for the opportunity. So just wanted to understand on your debt part. So now that you mentioned that we don't have any major capex plan, and we are focusing on generating free cash flow and considering our improved performance. So how do you see your debt repayment over the next 1 to 2 years?
We had already indicated earlier in the year that we intend to be around the same level at the end of March, so around the 300 crore net debt position end of March. Our expected debt levels in CFF, working capital has been slightly higher. They have continued to grow double digit in the last 3-4 months despite the events around the COVID. So there has been a bit of increase in their working capital debt levels. So today we stand at 454 crores net debt as of end of September. So I would look to bring that down by around 125 to 130 crores in the by end of the year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and about next year?
So we continue to have a cash month-on-month, quarter-on-quarter cash generating business. So the trend line would continue to be in that. We have no major capex outlined for this year or for next year. Mm-hmm. And we will continue to bring down the debt if there are no opportunities for reinvestment.
Mm-hmm. Fair enough. Okay. Yep. That's it from my side. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Naresh Vaswani from Sameeksha Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity and congratulations on great set of numbers. So this EBITDA margin, which you have, which has improved, how much of this was due to operating leverage? And you also mentioned about cost savings, which you have done. So how much was on that account? And also we had operations shift from Netherlands to India. If you can quantify into these three factors, that would be helpful. And and second, on the 14% growth which we have done, how much of this was due to COVID-related increased demand of your products, and your 12% guidance? How do you plan to achieve that? Whether by adding new clients or by adding new wins, that would be helpful if you can guide.
So I will answer that question in reverse order. So on the growth, I think I have already alluded, we have roughly 35 crores of new business in the first half of this year that will add to our top line next year. Plus, we have continued to grow with our current clients, and we see double-digit growth in many of our current clients, both domestic as well as internationally. In fragrance exports, particularly Southeast Asia, we have lost some business on the supply disturbances in the first quarter. We hope to regain that business as well. If you look at the sustainability, you talk about 14% year-on-year growth. I think there will be some impact, probably 1-2% impact of the previous quarter coming into this quarter in terms of growth. Being mindful of that, I think we are still poised for a steady 12% plus sustainable growth. As regards the cost, we had alluded 2 quarters back and before that we are taking steps. The cost structure of moving the Netherlands operations to India has already resulted in roughly 12 to 13 crores of annualized cost saving in this year, and you can see those effects of that following through. We have also restructured our business internally and made it more cost efficient, so that all of those things you can see in the cost structure. We are now on a sustainable cost level where we have no specific changes, neither new increases, neither any further reductions which are planned. And from here on, we will closely monitor the growth and the resourcing that we need on a quarter-on-quarter basis.
Right. So we are confident of clocking 20% margins?
So at the gross margin level, 43%, and around the 20% EBITDA level, we are confident to be sustainably around that level. I would just put a small caution that some of the international business is directly affected by the COVID situation in the first quarter. Even the second wave, there might be a 1 quarter up or down in the second half of the year, which depends on how the global demand pans out for the ingredients.
Mm-hmm. And the second question, on the balance sheet, intangible assets have increased by 265 crores in this first half. So this entire acquisition has gone into that, and are there no tangible assets in CSS right now?
Sir, you may want to answer this question.
So sure, I'll just unmute the line. Yes, please go ahead.
Yeah. Large part of the acquisition purchase price was fair value, and intangibles are largely arising out of that by way of formulations, the value by way of customer relationships and goodwill. So you are right. Large part of that is directly linked with completion of tranche 2 acquisition.
Okay, so any amount in the tangible asset for CSS right now?
Sorry, I didn't quite hear that.
Because what is the fair value of the tangible assets?
Oh, fair value of the tangible assets. So fair value of tangible assets is roughly 37 crores.
Okay, and this intangible assets which you have created, so what would be the expected amortization per year?
So we have well-defined policy for amortization of these intangible assets depending upon what type of assets these are. So it typically ranges between 10 to 15 years based on the useful economic life. Goodwill is not amortized. This is tested for impairment every year as required by the IFRS or Ind AS.
Sure. And one last question. You have mentioned that whenever you look for acquisitions, we target 20% ROCE, but right now CFF is around, you see the ROE, it is around 7.8%. So how do we plan to take it to 20%?
So, Kedar, you want to take that question?
No, sir. I think the 20% ROC is in INR. When we look at the European situation, we have a very low debt rate, roughly hovering around the 2%. So, at 7-8%, we are still seeing a very high value. Plus, as things we start to grow, there is synergies which are not taken into account in the current results. So, we can drive roughly around 500,000 of cost savings and additional 500,000 of synergy benefits as we start to operate the two companies and take benefit of the product development and supply chain on both sides.
Okay, and just last one, what was the capacity utilization in Q2 across all the assets?
So capacity utilization was similar to the last quarter of the previous fiscal, hovering around the 50% for the fragrance and flavor businesses and 80% for Mahad and Vapi facilities. At this moment, our China facility is operating at a very low level, 20-odd%, given the demand slackness on some of the raw materials.
Okay, sir. Thank you. All the best.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, a reminder to all the participants, please limit your question to 2 per participants. You may come back in the question queue if you have a follow-up. The next question is from the line of Bharat Seth from Quest Investment. Please go ahead.
Hi, Kedar. Congratulations on excellent performance. Hello.
Yeah, thank you.
Kedar, if you can give little more color, what kind of a synergy that we have can have with CFF going ahead, that is one. The second, we were working to win some international client and then converting them our local MNC also as a client. So where in this whole journey, where we are?
So firstly, on the CFF, as I alluded, we have roughly 500,000 euro synergy, which is low hanging immediate synergy on buying and supply chain. We also see an estimate another 500,000 of synergy based on management cost and development cost sharing across the various businesses. So this is the roadmap for the synergies of CFF integration into Keva Group. On the second question, the second question, first question was on synergy. Second question was on MNC.
Yeah.
We do have some inroads in global MNC. We are continuing our efforts and we are very close to actual business. So we have some products which are approved at various stages and there were some delays on account of COVID situation where the launches were put ahead, but we are already ready with the products and designs and we should be getting some actual business very soon.
Will it be for India business or international export also?
Both India and export.
And how big is the opportunity?
So initially, it will be small, 1 or 2 crores annualized business.
Okay.
But this will start to grow subsequently.
And can you say, give some color on this working capital scenario? Because in this quarter, inventory has shoot up because of even CFF also, as well as trade payable also has gone up. So if you can, what kind of a normal working capital cycle will be going ahead?
No, I think the normal working capital cycle, as we have mentioned earlier, we expect it to be lower, around the same levels as March end last year. This year quarter, we have taken steps to take additional inventory with longer payment cycles to the vendors. Given the supply chain, there were a lot of logistic issues. We have chosen to keep the inventories in our plants rather than on contracts, which will come in subsequently. I think this is the operation side in India fairly normalized in terms of logistics and deliveries. And we will then look to restore to our normal levels and reduce the inventory which we hold at this point. So another roughly 25 to 30 crores of additional inventory is present in the balance sheet as of end of September.
And receivable and payable side?
So receivable remains in the similar range. Payable, we have made a conscious effort and conscious discussion with the vendors that we will extend credit terms and we will keep the inventory in our books rather than taking the material on a deferred supply basis. Given that logistics and so all of these steps were taken in the first quarter when Corona was disturbing the supply chain and with a much higher level of uncertainty. The effect of that is seen in this quarter. We have subsequently restored and restoring our supply chain to normal levels, or normal basis. So that will start to flow out and inventories will come down in the second half of the year.
Okay. On last question again, I mean, this cost benefit or supply chain as well as synergy with CFF, so which is around 1 million euros. So in what time frame do we expect to achieve that?
So the supply chain synergies we expect to be around 500,000, and 500,000 is on the product development cost and management cost, which will get offset over both the all the businesses. The supply chain synergy typically we should start to see from January, as we have a 6-monthly procurement cycle at CFF. In the next cycle, we can start to work jointly, but within a year, we should be able to start to get benefit of the supply chain.
Okay, thank you. All the best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Levin Shah from ValueQuest. Please go ahead.
Yeah, sir. Thanks for the opportunity and congratulations for a wonderful set of numbers. So, firstly, on the now if you look at the margin, our gross margins have been around 44%, but because of the lower cost, we have been able to report like a 21% kind of margin. In terms of other costs now, so despite this kind of growth, we have seen flat other costs and also employee cost has remained largely flat. So, going forward, do we see some of these costs coming back and consequently that impacting the EBITDA margins? Or most of this cost is like a steady state cost going ahead?
So, this quarter we have a very much steady state cost in employee and fixed cost. We don't anticipate any, there is no one-off cost there. There is no specific increase, decrease. These are the base level cost at which we are operating the business. The margins in terms of gross margins have also expanded in this quarter on the stock that we had and the demand situation. We anticipate that this gross margin at 44 may come down a tad as things are getting more normal and we will service all the business, including some of the low margin business in exports, which we had sort of reduced priority for supply given the demand on the domestic side. So I think the gross margin level of around 43% is what we anticipate going forward. And if the demand situation continues as is, we do 300 plus crore quarters, our cost structure would remain similar to this quarter.
Okay, got it. Sir, and on the reverse part of the business, if we see, so there has been a substantial jump both in terms of revenue and margin. So you alluded to this part in your previous questions as well. But if you were to just ponder more upon this, what has led to this kind of growth in flavor segment and over here again, both the growth part and the margins, how sustainable are they? And if we see going ahead this performance is sustainable, then what are the key drivers that we look from this business?
So I have also mentioned this earlier that the flavor business, organic growth and new business, we have been continuing to grow at 12-15%. We had a certain loss of business of roughly 25 crores on account to Orange Oil, which has sort of overlaid on the underlying growth and made it look very flat. So the original 75 odd crore business is now growing, and this quarter it is 30 crores. So we see that run rate of 120 crores up from 75-80 crores 3-4 years ago. And this 25 crore business which we have lost is now completely out of the comparable year on year. So we see that this is the correct level, sustainable from here on. Food industry has been growing, and we are even witnessing further kind of uptick on processed foods and delivery of food, which will help the flavor industry growth rates, and we are part of that growth. So we see this as a sustainable base level from where we will continue to grow.
Okay, sir, and on the margins front, so...
on the flavor, margins. I just want to... just let me complete on the sale. I think
sure.
On the exports, I think we need to be mindful of if there is any... specific downturn on the result of Corona, because some of our exports in the Middle East goes to travel and people hospitality business in a way. So that business may be affected in the event that there is a very strong second wave and there is any disruption. As of now, there are no indications. Business continues to run normally. On the margin front, also this quarter has been a very good quarter for margins. As I alluded earlier, that exports as part of the flavor basket has been higher, leading to better margins. I think the 48-50% gross margin is a sustainable level at which we will continue to grow.
Okay. So basically, this EBIT margins of around 40-odd% that we have reported, there is no one-off component in that, right? And it is largely sustainable going forward as well.
Yeah, I think it is sustainable. I would be surprised if the gross margins did not correct a couple of percent. I think we had a very good or very low prices of raw materials post-corona, which has helped us in this quarter. So it will normalize a bit, but it is 1-2% difference on the gross margin. So 40% probably want to take 38-37% as the sustainable level.
Okay, got it. Thank you. Thanks a lot, sir, and happy Diwali and a prosperous new year to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, a reminder to the participants again. Please limit your question to 2 per participants. You may come back in the question queue if you have a follow-up. The next question is from the line of Nav Bharadwaj from Anand Rathi. Please go ahead.
Thank you for giving me the opportunity. First of all, if you could help me understand the increase in the goodwill and consolidation and the other intangible assets, the 201 crore number that we have on page number 12.
Just quickly, it is the goodwill arising out of the consolidation of CFS.
Okay. And the other intangible assets, what are we exactly capitalizing here?
Rikan, you may want to put the exact numbers and details on this.
Can I be unmuted? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
We can hear you.
Okay. Like I mentioned earlier, the purchase price was fair value through a professional valuer, and the assets which will have useful economic life, like the fragrance formulation, custom relationships, non-compete cheese, etc., etc. They were evaluated, and the breakup along with that and goodwill is the total amount of what you just see there. We can separately share with you breakup on a mail or on a separate call.
That will be very helpful, sir. Great. So probably we'll get in touch with you for that. And also, sir, historically we've been seeing that in the domestic market, our market share has been hovering around 12%. With the aggressive growth that we find in the company right now, in the domestic as well as in the international market, where do we see our market share a year or maybe 2 to 3 years henceforth going forward?
Our market share in the domestic has hovered around the 12% in last 2-3 years. I believe this quarter we would have gained some market share. And as we continue to grow at industry plus growth rates, our market share will continue to improve from the 12%. I expect it to be kind of growing at 0.2% per annum basis and increase from the 12% market share that we have today.
Even in the international market, sir, similar growth rates?
No, domestic market. International market, we are fairly small. Our market share is 3-4% in the markets where we are long positions, and the new markets, we are only a 1% player. So there is a long rope of or long area of growth there, and we will pick markets and specific categories and continue our growth strategy.
Oh, great. Thank you so much, sir. And a very happy Diwali to the entire team.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sachin Kisera from Swan Investment. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir, and congrats for a good set of numbers. In one of the previous questions, you mentioned that the aspiration of the chairman is to achieve a revenue of around $1 billion. So if you could tell us, first of all, is there any time frame that we are looking for? Do we have a roadmap for it? And secondly, do you think you can do it organically, or you need to do a lot of inorganic acquisitions to be able to achieve that?
So $1 billion is something like 6 times where we are today. And I think we will look at doing that both with organic and inorganic. And this decade, we should be touching that milestone.
Sure. And secondly, sir, when it comes to acquisitions, it was mentioned that because in Europe, the debt interest is very low, 2-2.5%. So we look at a much lower ROC vis-a-vis 20% that we do for India. But then, are we looking at a higher leverage when it is, because we also have a cost of equity, which is normally 12-13%.
Yes, we have a very almost 4 or 5 times leverage in the European acquisition.
Okay. My next question is regarding our ability to participate in large contracts with some of the multinationals which span across multiple geographies. If you could tell us, how are we positioned there, and do we see any significant wins possible in the next couple of years where, if we could make inroads in some of the large multinationals, multi-geography, large contracts?
So I think on the large multinational, multi-geography contracts, I think we are still a way ahead for us. I don't think any of those are going to materialize in the next 2 years. But at the global MNC, there is a large part of their business which is not multi-geography supply. It is single-geography supply, but large brand. Like, for example, Wheel brand in India is only present in India. It is a large brand in India, but not outside India. And similarly, there are various brands in the different geographies in Asia, particularly Southeast Asia, India, where we are operating, and some parts of Africa, where we are partnering with the global MNC with their specific requirement and understanding of their local brands or local jewel brands, as they call it. And I think our best chance and our next step of evolution is to address and take up business with the global MNC local brands in different regions, different countries. The global We already have number of large, well-entrenched suppliers, and we do not have any specific advantages if we had to supply, for example, in South Africa, we don't, or South America, we don't have any operations in the Americas today. So we are very much in Europe and India and Southeast Asia as our operating area. So we are looking at more the global MNCs, one region brands, then global MNC, global multi-region brands, which are which is not our USP.
Sure, sir. And sir, so to be able to keep increasing our market share going ahead, do we need to significantly ramp up our R&D capabilities, both in terms of the talent as well as in terms of the investments that we need to do?
So we have been consistently investing. I mentioned earlier in the year as well that our investments in last 2-3 years on R&D have been higher than the requirements, or as the growth rates were lower. We have brought down our investments in the R&D this year in line with the 4% R&D to sales ratio we project. And accordingly, we will continue to invest in R&D on that track record or that trend line. As we sales grow, we will continue to invest 3-4% of that into our R&D budgets for the next year.
Awesome. Thank you so much and wish you all the best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Anurag Patil from Roa Asset Managers. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity. Sir, our overseas fragrance division is continues to degrow. Can you throw some light on that side?
So I think the overseas fragrance business has a combination of global ingredient demand and business in Southeast Asia, which had been negatively affected in this quarter, particularly in July. It is subsequently restored and it is running well. The global demand has been soft for some of the ingredients, and that's a factor of the economic slowdown and as a result of the corona, particularly in the fine fragrances and travel-related businesses. So this, we're seeing that this will come back after the restoration of the normal business.
So Q3, can we say it will be flat or will there be growth or it will take some time to growth to come back there?
No, so again, we have had a few, even in this quarter, August and September were quite in line with the expected trend. July is where we had a dip in the sales. So we don't anticipate a very big drop. The growth will be there. The growth will continue quarter on quarter. We just have a smaller pace as we had this decline in some of the demand. I don't have a exact way of knowing what happens in the ingredient demand as the global scenario with the corona and travel and fine fragrances is still question or still with evolving. But underlying major demand, I would say 85% of our international business is not affected. The 15% which is affected has already been factored in this quarter. So I don't see any further decline from here on this base. As things start restoring, we will see the uptick coming there as well.
Okay. Thank you very much and happy Diwali to you.
The next question is from the line of Rohit Nagraj from Sunidhi Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity and congratulations on a great set of numbers. So the first question is on the R&D spend. You just explained earlier that we'll be reducing it from about 50 crores to maybe closer to 40-45 crores. So has that effect come in our first half numbers?
Yes, so if you see this quarter, these numbers are at the sustainable level. We will maintain at these levels.
Okay, and the second question is for the synergy benefits that we have talked about. So is it safe to assume maybe from 2022 onwards, calendar year 2022 onwards, will be able to realize this $1 million of synergy benefits on a continuous basis?
Yes, but the synergy benefits are already started to flow in, so it's not entirely that it will happen in one quarter. Certain raw material buying, we have already started coordinating and we have been able to reduce the prices for CFS. You can see that in the bit of the margin expansion. But overall, this is the quantum which when you see on an annualized year-on-year basis, the efficiency at CFS will improve by about $500,000 on the cost of their raw material. The remaining $500,000 is a synergy we need to drive using the product development libraries and their know-how and our combining our markets and our know-how and combining to their markets.
Yeah, and just one last clarification on the capacity utilization. Can you just again tell the numbers overall China and flavors and fragrance division separately? Thank you.
So China is at a very low capacity utilization at the moment, 20%. For the balance operations, Mahad and Vapi continue to be above 80%, and the fragrance and flavor plants are at around the 50-55% utilization.
Thanks a lot, and Diwali wishes to your entire team. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jignesh Makwana from Asian Market Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity. I have just one bookkeeping question. Can we have the breakup of the organic business, which is excluding the CFF for the fragrance and the flavor for this particular quarter? And what is the revenue mix of CFF in terms of flavors and fragrance? Thank you.
As far as the organic business, we have clocked 314 crores this quarter.
Mm-hmm.
14% up from same quarter last year. In mm-hmm. relation to the CFF, it is only a fragrance company. There is no flavor business in CFF at the moment.
Okay. Thank you. That's all for me.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of C. Srihari from TCA Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity. And congrats on a good set of numbers. My first question is, you claim that you don't need any significant CapEx for the medium term. So based on the current capacity, what is the kind of optimal sales we can generate? And secondly, this contract manufacturing business, the legacy business that you have inherited, I think around 50-odd crores per annum. So what is the tenure of that? And hypothetically, if you're able to use that capacity for your own product, what is the kind of revenue you can potentially generate? Thank you.
So, first question is in the capacity currently. So, without CFF, we will factor and reply on capacity and way forward subsequently. Without CFF, we have capacity, as I mentioned, at operating between 50-55%. And we can easily double or make our revenue 2.5 times with the installed capacity. There will be small incremental capexes, 4-5 crores, which we may need to do in the ramp up with automation and some additional larger equipment. But by and large, the capacity for doubling the revenue from current base already is in place. On the ingredients, I think we have almost exhausted the capacity in terms of utilization. Our China plant is where there is adequate capacity for expansion, but we will have to work through the strategy on which products we want to make. And we will have a strategy of improving the margin and improving the profile of the so higher value-added products we will try to make, and we will hive off some of the products to other manufacturers and get it made from generic ingredient manufacturers, which will be our way of increasing the revenue, but without additional capex. So 2.5 times of revenue on the
current domestic or organic non-CFF business is already with the CapEx that is already in place. On the CFF also, we have done a CapEx of almost €1 million last year. So we have adequate capacity for the next 3-4 years. Exact revenue on that, we can come back to you once we have a detailed plan for the next 3-4 year strategy.
Yeah, and the contract manufacturing portion?
Contract manufacturing, this is a multi-year contract with a large global FMCG MNC. So it has been running almost since 2000, early 2000s, so 2003-04, 15-16 years. So it is a 3-4 year old. So it is renewed every 3-4 years, but there is no risk that or very limited risk. It's a relationship well over 2 decades. And that capacity we are utilizing almost dedicatedly for the global MNC. I think we can definitely, so there is a €12 million or €15 million sales of that in the full annualized basis. And that is the kind of additional business we would do in if that capacity were to be available for our core business. So another €15 million business we could do in the event that this core or contract manufacturing for any reason closes down. You know, we will have to put additional efforts on the new client acquisition, which we will take up.
So this current contract lasts till which year?
Current contract lasts till end of December next year, so 2021 December.
Okay, so are you seriously contemplating?
Sorry to interrupt, but may I please request you to rejoin the queue for your follow-up, please? As we have people waiting for the turn, thank you. The next question is from the line of Jayesh Gandhi from Harshad Gandhi Securities. Please go ahead.
Congrats on good set of numbers. So I have a bookkeeping question similar to what earlier caller had asked. We have a goodwill increase of 160 crores and an intangible increase of probably 100 crores. So it's like 260 crores of increase of if we totally say categorize it as intangibles. And the acquisition of CFF, whose net worth is just 37 crores, is for 49% we have paid 141 crores. Am I missing on something? You know, the numbers are not matching, sir. Hello?
Yeah.
Should I take that?
Yes, you can.
So just to clarify, earlier when 51% stake was acquired, on the balance sheet, it was continuing to be shown as investments only because it was a joint venture. When we acquired remaining 49%, it became a full-fledged subsidiary, and therefore the accounting has been done for entire purchase consideration, that is both tranches put together, which as I explained earlier was driven by a process of fair valuation conducted by a professional valuer, and based on that the values have been arrived at.
The fair value of total acquisition is 250 crores as of what we have put in the balance sheet.
Yes.
Thank you. We take the last question from the line of Ujwal Shah from Quest Investment. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for taking my question, sir. So, while during the call, you did mention that, you know, some business was lost in Southeast Asia, and you will regain the same in coming time. Can you throw some light what led to us losing that business, and by when do we see that coming back to us?
So they, I think they, there is not any one specific business loss. We were in the last part of June when we had a shutdown or supply disturbance in April and early part of May. We were in the catch-up mode for the domestic demand, and we had deprioritized some of the low-margin business or lower-margin business, and
given priority to the domestic and higher margin business. Some of that business in July we did not do, so it seems that the export business, particularly in Southeast Asia, we have lost some business. But this is something where we are in contact with the customers and we hope to regain that business as we go. So it is not a permanent loss. It is a tactical or a couple of months loss of business due to supply chain issues. And the customers have been sympathetic and understanding of the situation.
Sir, how large was this, if you can quantify?
About 5-7 crores of business.
Okay, sir. And so lastly, in terms of international fragrance and domestic fragrance, are the gross margins quite similar and or is it quite different? It's low internationally. So if product mix changes back once international fragrance business is back on track, do we see lower margins because of the product mix?
Yes, to some extent. There is the international business is around the 40% gross margin level and the domestic is maybe around the 45-46%. So there will be small impact. But we are still very confident to manage it in the gross margin level around 43% for the total group.
So your margin guidance stands for next year as well. So FY22, can we held on to our 20% kind of EBITDA margins and this 43% gross margin?
Yes, our attempts and our confidence is that we will maintain this track record.
Great, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question for today. I would now like to hand the conference back to the management for closing comments.
Thank you. I hope we have been able to answer all your questions satisfactorily. Should you need any further clarifications or would like to know more about the company, please feel free to contact our team or CDR India. Thank you once again for taking the time to join us on this call. I wish you all a happy Diwali. Thank you.
Thank you. On behalf of SHK